Let's pray.
Father, we thank you for bringing the Casey family, Lord, in our midst, for us to see your work that you're doing in the Philippines, in those two homes, Lord God, with those children that were abused by family or friends, Lord God, that they trusted. Father, I pray for strength for them. I pray that you touch your people's hearts, Lord, in this church, that we'll be able to be a part of that work, Lord, financially, Father. And as we pray for them, we also give, Lord. Father, I pray for your message this evening. I ask for your blessings, Lord God, for it. Bless my preparations, Lord God. At the same time, I ask that you override it, Lord. Let you and you alone speak to your people. Just use me as your mouthpiece, Father God. And I pray that the Holy Spirit and all of them, Lord God, will give them the truth that you want them to know. I pray for that brother or sister that are stagnant, Lord God. I pray that you move them to a more intimate relationship with you, Father. And I pray for that soul, Lord, that has not surrendered their lives to you. I pray that this will be the evening that you will open their hearts and move them, Lord God, to accept you as their Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, tonight we're still in our journey in the book of Corinthians. And I entitled our message tonight with the classic quote, all for one, one for all. If you're a classic junkie like me, the Three Musketeers, that's from the Three Musketeers. But this one, we're saying here, everyone for Christ and Christ for everyone. That's what we're saying. In chapter 12, we're going to be tackling the spiritual gifts and the unity and the diversity of a church and how Paul spoke to the Corinthian church. Let's begin. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Now, let's just sidetrack for a minute or two about these idols that Paul was talking about. So the Corinthian church before were pagans. So, but at the same time, I want us to again review this as a church about idols. In chapter 8, verse 4, Paul wrote, "So what about eating meat that has been offered to idols? Well, we all know that an idol is not really a god, and that there is only one God. So if you are still worshiping an idol, please read this. Please listen. What am I trying to say? Am I saying that food offered to idols has some significance, or that idols are real gods? No, not at all. I am saying that these sacrifices are offered to demons, not to God. So your idols, if you have one, there's demons in there. And I don't want you to participate with demons." And this is in Isaiah. "The blacksmith stands at his forge to make a sharp tool, pounding and shaping it with all his might. His work makes him hungry and weak. It makes him thirsty and faint. Then the wood carver measures a block of wood and draws a pattern on it. He works with chisel and plane and carves it into a human figure. He gives it human beauty and puts it in a little shrine. He cuts down cedars. He selects the cypress and the oak. He plants the pine in the forest to be nourished by the rain. Then he uses part of the wood to make a fire. With it, he warms himself and bakes his bread. Then, yes, it's true, he takes the rest of it and makes himself a god to worship. He makes an idol and bows down in front of it. He burns part of the tree to roast his meat and to keep himself warm. He says, 'Ah, that fire feels good.' Then he takes what's left and makes his god a carved idol. He falls down in front of it, worshiping and praying to it. 'Rescue me,' he says. 'You are my God.' Such stupidity and ignorance. Their eyes are closed and they cannot see. Their minds are shut and they cannot think. The person who made the idol never stops to reflect. Why, it's just a block of wood. I burned half of it for heat and used it to bake my bread and roast my meat. How can the rest of it be a god? should I bow down to worship a piece of wood? Now, this is just talking about that idol that was made out of wood. It could also be made out of, you know, cement or whatever. But there are also those other idols that we've spoken about before. But this is in particular talking about the idols that are made by our hands. Amen? So this is just Paul speaking about it again. And we're going to go back to our verse here. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Paul is answering another question raised by the Corinthians in their letter to him. He spoke about the mute idols. At one time, the Corinthians had been led by various influences to worship them. The Corinthian church, as we'll see, had an abundance of spiritual gifts. So their trouble came not from a lack of exposure to the gifts, but a failure to properly use them. See, look at this, that you won't be ignorant. So when you get in trouble, when you're driving, and you didn't know a certain rule in that town that you drove in, and they bring you to court, and they're going to tell you you broke a you made a violation, now you're going to have to go to jail. You can't say, I didn't know the law. Because if you didn't know, now you'll know that ignorance is not an excuse. And it's the same thing with God. Being ignorant about the truth, about God and His will and His ways, is all right here in the Bible. I'm also speaking to the believers here. You call yourself a believer, I'm hoping that you're reading this book from cover to cover. Because there's a lot of great truths, I'm finding out, in the Bible. There's so much, everything. You want to learn about investing? Read the Bible. You want to learn about how to be in partnership with someone? Read the Bible. Everything is in the Bible. You want to improve your relationship? We talked about it last week, right? What's the key? Is it submit to your husbands or submit to your wives? Filipinos, submit to your wives. No. So we talked about that last week, but no, everything. We can't be ignorant about our faith. We need to read up. We need to study. Amen? We need to get in there. And then Paul was saying here, because someone told him, so in the letter, they said that these guys that are speaking in tongues, they could be cursing Jesus as they're talking. And Paul is saying there that no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. What do we see there too? That the Holy Spirit is the one that opens the hearts and the minds of people when they pray to receive Christ. Amen? It's not their common sense. It cannot be their common sense because this is spiritual. Why is it that I've shared the same gospel, same verses, same testimony to different people, but different reactions all the time? Different. Somebody will turn it down. Somebody will ask more questions and turn it down. Somebody won't ask questions and accept Jesus. Somebody will ask more questions but then accept Christ. It's all the same verses but different. But it's the Holy Spirit that opens the hearts of people. So if you have not shared the gospel for quite some time because you're thinking that you can't do a good job, you know what? You don't have to do a good job. You just have to know the truth that it's the Holy Spirit that will do it. You just need to be surrendered to the Holy Spirit. You have to know what you're sharing. You have to know what you're sharing. You have to know what you're saying. But it's not up to you. The conversion is not up to you. It's up to the Holy Spirit. Now, Paul is affirming them that, hey, those guys that are speaking in tongues there, don't worry. They can't curse Jesus. Because the one that's giving them that power to speak in tongues is the Holy Spirit. That's what Paul is saying here. Okay? We're going to go forward. Now we're going to talk about spiritual gifts. In 1 Peter 4:10, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. In Ephesians 4, 11 to 12, it reads, "And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ." It's the Holy Spirit that gives everyone. Now, it's just not the people that sit up front. So if you're thinking you're not going to get any gifts, so you'll sit in the back because you don't want to participate in the work of God, guess what? You're wrong. If you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit gives gifts, spiritual gifts to everyone, whether you like it or not. We all have it. The thing is, we have free will to use it, to learn more about it, to surrender to God and be used by Him, and to maximize that gift that God has given you. Everyone. It's not just for your benefit. It really isn't for your benefit. It's for the benefit of the church, the whole church. Now, if you are a part of this church and you have not stepped up to the calling that you know God is calling you, you know what you're doing to yourself? You're making yourself a bonsai tree. You're a tree, but you're keeping yourself in a pot to be looked at in a table. How cute. You just want to be cute. You don't want to be a redwood tree like everybody else, to provide shade, to provide lumber, to provide oxygen, to take in the carbon dioxide. You don't want to be that. You want to be a cute bonsai. We need to be aware that the Holy Spirit has given all of us a gift. Now, if you still don't know what your spiritual gift is, you need to pray about it. You need to ask God what it is. And if you already know what it is and you're delaying yourself, you're delaying what? Blessings for your life. You are. And you know what? It's going to be hard for you. I know. I delayed it for many years, and it was so hard for me. As I kept running away from God, He kept giving me trouble. So it's just like Jonah. As he kept running away, trouble came. Trouble came. Oh yeah, like Jonah, I wanted to just die. Lord, just take me. I don't want to be that. I don't want to be a pastor. I don't think I can be consistently good. And am I consistently good? No, God is consistently good. Amen? So don't delay. If you know that gift that God has given you, it's not for you to keep. It's for you to obey and yield to God and be used by Him. Amen? In Romans 12, 6, 8, it reads, "In His grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others," let me just pause. Prophecy is not saying, oh, this is what's going to happen in the future. I could see, I could tell. Prophesy is preaching. Okay, if you were gifted to preach the truth that's already in here, there's no more truth that you need to discover or that God's going to reveal to you other than that's already in here. Everything that God will do in the now and in the future, it's already all written down. It's just has to be you. So if you have the gift of prophesying, which is preaching, preach. That's what Paul's saying. Preach. Do it. If your gift is serving others, serve them. Serve them well. Our deacons, Deacon Orly and Deacon Nori, Brother Don, they're all, Brother Deacon John, they're all given this gift to help and serve others. You know, and I praise them for the gift that they have, because there are many times that I can't do, like when somebody's moving and they need their stuff moved from point A to point B and I can't be there. Praise God that the deacons are there and the other guys that are more than willing to share their time and their energy to help the other people. That's what Paul is saying. If you have that gift, do it. Serve them well. If you are a teacher, teach well. I was waiting for Richard and I to have an eye contact, and he's doing a good job. We have a teacher. Deacon John's teaching too. We have two Bible studies every Sunday from 4 to 5. If you need to learn more about the faith, there's sharing, and there is the book of Revelation, and right now they're doing the beginner's class for your faith. If you want to learn more, we have teachers, and they're teaching well. We have Bible studies that we place from Northwest, the North Valleys with Pastor Charles. It's all there. So I'm talking to the people that are not taking advantage of these things. Why? Are you really that good now with your faith? You've memorized your faith? You know it? Or are you just too busy? Sunday's not enough, I'm telling you. Sunday is not enough. Even if I talk your ear out for 2 hours, it won't be enough. Because you're going to immerse yourself in the world for 7 days. Right? Because you're only at church for 3 hours, and then we have potluck 4.5, right? but then you're going to be in the world. That's going to consume you. That's going to pollute your mind. I'm talking to the youth, too. Youth, the young adults. If you're not part of the group here, you need to be part of the group. Because your Facebook's polluting your mind. Other than the Snapchat and everything, I can't keep up. There's so many. Right? And your school is polluting your mind. At work for us adults, you just need to go to a break room and you'll hear all the F-bombs that you need to hear in your life. Right? So you need to immerse yourself to the Word of God. That's why we got prayer meetings on Wednesdays. It's like a middle of the week worship where we fellowship with each other. We give a brief devotional. And we pray for everyone's needs. And we rest on God. And we practice our faith. You need that. And then there's Bible studies on Friday and Saturday. So it's just all plugged in there. So if you haven't been doing none of that, and then you barely come on Sundays, and then you're wondering why your faith is so dull, why you keep stumbling, why you can't grow, well, let me say this, okay? If you will only eat once a week, are you going to be a healthy person? No. I don't think so. Especially for Filipino. What? Eat? No. What? What are you talking about? I eat 6 times in a day. There's merienda. There's midtime breakfast. There's, you know, it's everything. Every time, every move that you're doing as a Filipino, you're eating. You're eating something. You're driving, you're eating. You get off your car, you're eating, right? We're always eating. You go to church, you're going to eat later, right? You go to prayer meeting, you're going to eat afterwards. We're always eating. Half of our Bible studies is about eating. An hour and a half of eating, an hour of talking, and then 30 minutes of studying. That's why we're gaining weight. No. But we need to immerse ourselves to the Word of God with the people of God. But then that won't work if the people that are gifted to teach are not doing it. The people that are gifted to serve are not doing it and aren't stepping up. Right? So how about you? What's your gift? And how come you're not stepping up? Why? Why are you keeping it to yourself? Why are you madamot? Stingy. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. We need a lot of this. We need a lot of encouragers. Other than critics. So mind you, there's no critics here, okay? There's no spiritual gift of criticizing. Okay? So if you're good in criticizing, that's not a spiritual gift, okay? Encouragement is what's needed. If you see a brother or a sister for the first time after a long time at church, what do? You don't say, problema ka, no? You got a problem, huh? No, you encourage them. Praise God you're here. I haven't seen you for a long time. How have you been? I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're okay. Is there anything I can pray for you? Need to encourage them, right? You can't be like the other one. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. The word there is seriously. Not half-heartedly. Seriously. Because we're not playing a game here. This is serious. This is people's lives. We're dealing with people's souls. Amen? You're dealing with your soul and that person's soul and their family. They come here for counseling. They come to you for counseling. Help me, I'm arguing with my wife. What do? Are you going to be ready? Are you going to be ready with your spirit-filled life? Or are you going to be shocked again? Oh my gosh, oh, let me call pastor. No, right there, you need to be the one to be ready to respond. Amen? That's why you need to know what your gift is. You need to know what your gift is. And if you already know what your gift is, you need to surrender and respond. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. Amen? Kindness. Very rare, right? A lot of people, there's a lot more rude people than kind people. Right? Sad. That's sad. They're only nice to you if they need something, is the human nature. That's why it's a spiritual gift, you see? Kindness is a gift from the Holy Spirit. So are you still your old grumpy self? Or are you manifesting the gift of the Holy Spirit? And are you now the kind and gentle soul that God intends you to be? What is your gift? And why are you not responding to that gift that God has given you? Going back to chapter 12 in Corinthians, there are diversities of gifts. Praise God. I'm praising God that we all have different gifts. Because if we're all pastors here, I'm going to be preaching to myself, right? We're going to have, what, 85 services? Because nobody's going to want to listen to the other person. We have different gifts. Why? Because that's what's needed. Just like in the football team. I agree that football is a better team sport than basketball, although I love basketball. Football is the better team sport because even if you have the best running back in the world and the best quarterback in the world, if you have the Dallas Cowboys line, no, I'm kidding. If you have a weak line, offensive line, ooh. They're going to get tackled. The ball's not going to move. Actually, it's going to move. You're going to move backwards. Right? It's going to move backwards. Every block is needed. That pass is needed. That guy running is needed. Everything is needed. Different functions, one goal. The goal is to make a touchdown. Same thing with the church. Different gifts, one goal. Amen? Different gifts, one goal. Again, the question is, what's your gift? And why keeping it to yourself? But the same Spirit. Diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. Look, we were just blessed by the Lord to know about this ministry in the Philippines, helping those girls. I can't help but to be really moved by that, because those girls are helpless. If there is one thing you want to irk me with, is that taking advantage of a young girl or boy. That's you pushing my button. And I'm so glad you guys are there doing what you're doing. And I'm really asking for your help. But pray to God on if He's gonna move you to help, because that's really neat. That's a great ministry. There's that ministry. There's the ministry of the shoeboxes, right? That gives those gifts every year. There's all sorts of different ministries, but one Lord. It's just the question again goes back to you. How about you? Are you responding to the gift that God has given you? Are you using it or are you wasting it? And there are diversities of activities, but it's the same God who works in all, who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. The triune God was highlighted. Amen? Note the explicit show of the triune God there. The gifts are linked to the Spirit. The ministries are linked to the Son. The operations are linked to the Father. The doctrine of Trinity is the bedrock upon which all other doctrines are built. Amen? Paul here uses the beautiful mystery of the Trinity to demonstrate to the Corinthians that just as there is diversity within the Godhead, Father, Son, Spirit, yet only one God, there is also diversity in spiritual gifts, but only one church. The diversity of gifts should serve to promote unity within the church, not division and competition. See, nobody's competing. We shouldn't be competing with anyone. We shouldn't be. You know, the sport of golf, you're not competing with anybody else. You're competing with yourself. That's why I think it's the hardest one, because I can't beat myself. That's why I quit it the minute I picked it up. It's so hard to defeat myself. But it's the same thing. We need to know that there's different functions of the Trinity. I can try to explain the Trinity to you, but you'll probably still be confused if you're not going to be led by the Holy Spirit. Right? Because it defies all logic. There's three in one, and one in three. But that's their function. Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And this is where Paul shows it again. For to one is given the word of wisdom, going back to spiritual gifts, through the Spirit. To another, the word of knowledge, through the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healings from the same Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, different kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. Paul lists four broad categories of spiritual gifts, each with a specific purpose. First, the special gifts are to equip God's people. The second, the speaking gifts are to explain God's truth. Third, the serving gifts are to enable God's work. Fourth, the sign gifts are to establish God's authority. You know, in ancient times, before, God had to show signs, right? Has to show signs of miracles, healings, tongues, and interpretation of tongues to validate the word of His spokesman. So that was needed before. But once the Bible or the Word of God was completed, there was no further need for a word of revelation because God has said all that He intended to say in the Bible. So today, if someone announces, "I have a word from God," and it's not in the Bible, ignore it. Okay? The Scripture is closed. You can't remove or add to it. Amen. And the last part there says, "He wills." You see that God is sovereign, right? God is sovereign. It is His choice, not yours. So if you want to be a preacher, but you were given a different gift to be, let's say, to be an encourager, you can't push that issue. If I don't want to be a preacher and I just want to be helping, obviously I couldn't push that issue. I guess I could push it, delay it, and make myself suffer until I finally surrender to Him. Because God is sovereign. Amen? We have to know this. And you know what? Praise God that He is sovereign, because He knows better than us. You agree? He knows better than you and me. He knows your beginning and your end. We just know today. We plan tomorrow. We know of yesterday. But God knows from the beginning and the end. In Matthew, we're going to talk about the parable of the three servants. Talk about talents and gifts. But before I get there, going back here, the Holy Spirit sovereignly determines which gift or gifts each believer should have. Given to each one for the profit of the church, God works in believers to benefit the entire body, not just the individual Christian. Various gifts are distributed to bring diversity among the unified body, even as a human body has many parts and functions. The word of knowledge appears to be the ability to teach doctrine. The word of wisdom refers to practical application of knowledge. That's what wisdom is. If you want to call yourself wise, you have to apply what you've learned. You can't just know it and keep it in your pocket. Okay? Whatever you've learned, whatever God has revealed to you, in order for you to be wise, you need to apply what you've learned. Faith here is the capacity to believe in God for extraordinary deeds. It's not about faith to come into the faith with Christ. It's the faith about the extraordinary things. Miracles is the ability to perform miraculous wonders, similar to Moses and the prophets. Prophecy is telling of a revelation from God, either new revelation or divine explanation of what was revealed in the past. Discerning of spirits may refer to the ability to distinguish the works of God from demonic activity in the church. Like, you have to be able to discern if you're hearing a false prophet or not. So that's, people have that gift. Some people have that gift better than others, right? Interpretation of tongues is the ability to explain or translate the tongues spoken in the congregation so that the entire group might benefit. Like what Michael did earlier, he was saying that I would speak in Visayan, but a lot of the white folks would not be able to understand me. That's why I'd rather speak in English. I think I got it. I don't speak Visaya though, but kind of got the drift there. I've been hanging out with a lot of them for quite some time. But then we see that the Holy Spirit is sovereign. And then we're going to see in Matthew, when Jesus gave this parable about the three servants. Again, the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a long trip. He called together his servants and entrusted his money to them while he was gone. So he was gone for a long time, just like Jesus. Jesus has been gone for a long time, right? He's resurrected, but he hasn't come back yet to us. This is just like him giving us. And he gave 5 bags of silver to one, 2 bags of silver to another, and 1 bag of silver to the last, dividing it in proportion to their abilities. He then left on his trip. Now this is, in another translation, they use the word talents, right? The talents, one talent is 6,000 denarii. In 2011, the conversion of a denarius was converted to $3.62 US dollar, one denarii. And in one talent, so you have to change that, 5 talents, right? 2 talents. So in one talent, in one denarius, $3.62. Times 1 talent, which is 6,000, is equal to $21,720. That's 1 talent. Okay, and we see here that one got 5 talents, one got 2 talents, and one got one. So if we apply it to ourselves here, everybody, like what we said earlier, if you've surrendered to Jesus as your Lord, the Holy Spirit has given you a gift. He has given you a gift. Some have more gifts than the other. But the question is, are you using it? The servant who received the 5 bags of silver began to invest the money and earned 5 more. The servant with 2 bags of silver also went to work and earned 2 more. But the servant who received the 1 bag of silver dug a hole in the ground and hid the master's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. After a long time, okay? A long time, not 1 week, not 2 weeks, not 3 weeks. After a long time. And you know what? That person who dug a hole, in their time, that was considered doing something safe. It was safe to do. Okay? So, but the other guys went to work. The other guys went to work with the talent that they were given. They made it work. They did something with their time. That was a long time, right? And they made something out of what God has given them or what their master has given them. How about you? How about us? What are you doing with the talent, with the gift that God has given you? With that spiritual gift that He has given you, what are you doing with it? Are you just enjoying all the fruits of this land? A land flowing with milk and honey? And that's all we're just doing? Drinking the honey? Eating the honey? Enjoying the land? Not doing anything for God? The God that we always think, Lord, thank you for all the blessings that you have given me. Please give me more blessings so I can just continue, and I'll pray to you again as soon as you give me more blessings. What are we doing? After a long time, their Lord came back. So he who had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Don't you want to hear that? Don't you want to hear that from our Lord? Well done, good and faithful servant. Do you want to hear that? More than the applause of the people for your award at work, Employee of the Year, woo! I know if you work hard, you deserve it. Good for you. But don't you want to hear this from your Lord, from our Lord? Well done, good and faithful servant. Well done, good and faithful servant. And then he goes to the second, same thing. You see this? The guy, the other guy had 5 more, right? And the other one had 2, but they both got the same commendation. Well done, good and faithful servant. There was no difference. The guy with more talents did not get a different praise from his Lord. It's the same thing with us. The pastors will not get more praises than the guy that was just throwing trash at church. The missionaries will not get more praises than someone who just randomly shares the gospel to his co-workers and his friends. God knows what he has given you. And he knows what you can handle. And he knows if you're just being lazy and neglecting the gift that he has given you. And we'll see here. Same commendation. You don't need to try to get more spiritual gifts. You don't need to try to convert 1,000 people, because actually it's really not up to you anyway, to get the commendation that you think you're trying to seek from God. Because if you're faithful with what He has given you, He will say the same thing. Well done, good and faithful servant. We all should strive to hear that, right? That should be the goal. There you go. Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look there, you have what is yours. He did not know God. If you know God, you won't be afraid of him. Amen? If you know him and you know that his love overpowers your fear, then you shouldn't be scared of making a mistake for him. Amen? He's not expecting perfection from you if you're going to serve him with the talent that he has given you, with the spiritual gift that he has given you. He's not expecting perfection. He's expecting faithfulness. That's what he's expecting. He's expecting you to be faithful, not perfect. Who said you need to be perfect? Because I hear this all the time. I'm not ready yet, man. Not ready. Mm-mm. So when are you going to be ready? I'll know when I'm ready. Like when I'm walking that straight and narrow. Really? You'll never walk that straight and narrow because first of all, you're not taking the plunge. You're lacking the faith. You have to trust him as you move forward and you get out of your comfort zone. A turtle will never get anywhere until he sticks his neck out, right? We have a turtle at the house, and every now and then he tries to escape Gianna's little box. And it's very entertaining for me as I watch it because I'll hear it go. Because it's sliding down, and it tries it again, and it'll just stop. And it doesn't go anywhere when it stops, when it goes back inside its shell. So what kind of a Christian are you? A turtle? You can still move. Even if you're a turtle Christian, you can still move. You just need to stick your neck out. Because really, it's the Holy Spirit that will empower you. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. And look at the if you know it, you know what's going to be said, right? But his Lord answered to him, "You wicked and lazy servant." Wicked and lazy servant. "You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming, I would have received back my own with interest." Makes perfect investment sense, right? If you're not going to do anything, might as well just put it in the bank. It's going to be this much, but it's going to be something compared to nothing. "Therefore, take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. Because he is faithful with little, will be faithful with much." The first two servants received the same reward, even though they had received different amounts of money. Their reward was based on faithfulness, not on the size of their responsibilities. The smallest task in God's work may receive a great reward if we are faithful in performing. The wicked servant was lazy and unfaithful because if he really had feared his master, he would have at least deposited the money with the bankers. Then the master would have received back the investment plus interest. This proverb, this parable illustrates that a person must use what God has given or else lose it. This includes abilities, spiritual gift, and it goes with your material possession too. Now what do you see there? Where do you want to be? Who do you want to be? Oh, who are you? If you are the servant with the 5 talents, keep up the good work. Because the other wicked and lazy servants need you. We need you to encourage. We need you to push the wicked and lazy servants. And if you're the person with the 2 talents, don't worry about not having 5. Be faithful with what you have. And keep moving. Keep your faith and be faithful to God. Because you are needed as much as the next guy. And you will hear, "Good job," right? "Well done. Good and faithful servant." That's what you want to hear. Now, if you are the wicked, lazy, sleeping, if you're sleeping right now, I hope you hear this, that you need to be aware that the talents, the gifts that God has given you, He needs you to use it for His kingdom. You need to use it for His kingdom. Because God will just use the next person, and you won't be part of the work that He's doing. And you're the one who's removing yourself from the blessing that God has intended to give you in the first place. Amen? So let's keep our eyes on Jesus. We're going to move here. Is this 1486 or I got another? For to everyone who has more will be given and will have abundance, but from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. He's not a believer in the first place. A believer will always be of use for the Lord. A believer does not fear God, but reverent fear is what we have. Reverent fear. He who does not have perfect love, because perfect love casts out fear, right? So if you know God and who He truly is, you will not have fear, just like this guy. Now, the question is, do you love Him? Do you love Jesus? Do you love Jesus? Not a whole lot, but that's all right. We'll take it. And Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. If you love Jesus, you will keep His commandments. If you love Jesus, you will keep His commandments. So if you love Him, you will keep His commandments. So if you're not keeping His commandments, then you have to ask yourself, maybe I don't love Him. Because love is not fear. If you fear me, keep my commands. Nope. If you love Him, we obey God in response to the love that He has given us, and in return, we love Him in return, right? That's why we do His commands. That's why we obey. That's why we serve, because we love Him. We love Him. Everything that He has done for us, we appreciate out of our gratitude. We obey Him, not fearing Him. Oh, He's going to stop blessing me if I don't obey. He just stopped blessing you right there. And what are the commandments? Then one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, perceiving that he had answered them, asked Jesus, which is the first commandment of all? Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. This is the first commandment. And the second, like it, is this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. So if you love Jesus, you obey His commands. Amen? And these are His commands. We give our all to Him, not parts of it. Not some of it, all. You give all your heart, not part of your heart. Well, I'll give all my heart to Him when He finally makes my wife submit to me. I'll give all my heart to Him once He makes my husband love me. I'll serve Him with all my strength once my children are back to me and are behaving. You give Him those conditions, right? But Jesus is saying all of it, whether or not things are working out for you. It's hard. Amen? Life as a believer is hard. It's impossible. But with God, you can do all things. Amen? I hope that your amen is true. Because by the minute we walk out this door, challenges will face you. People that God will give you an opportunity to minister to will be in front of you. I hope that your amen is true. I hope that you, when you say you love Christ, you will obey His commands. I hope that you will always have that burden for the lost. I hope that you will always have that love for Him, that you want to obey Him. Amen? I hope that's true. Let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for your message this evening. We thank you for your love, Lord God, that you have given to all of us. When we surrendered our lives to you and accepted you as our Lord, Father, we thank you for that love that you revealed to us. And that we finally opened our eyes to it and our hearts to it. Father, we thank you for that truth. Right now, Father, I want to ask, Lord, that you give all of us this message, Lord, for us to always remember it throughout the week. That this is just not a message here and we leave it here. Father, I pray that you will make us hear this in our hearts and in our minds as we go through the week. The minute we walk out the doors of this church, Lord God, that we apply it so we'll be wise, Lord. We'll apply it, Father. I pray for the brother and the sister who has not opened their lives to the spiritual gifts that you have given them. I pray that they will finally yield to you and surrender to you. To finally say, Lord, go ahead, use me. That despite their inability or imperfection, Father, that they will not worry because you are in control. Because it is you who's going to work through them. Father, I pray for a movement, Lord God, caused by your people because of our love for you, that we will obey your commands and that we will surrender to you and that we will be faithful. In Jesus' name we pray.